Three government reports were released: the well-known 9/11 Commission report, the NIST report, and the FEMA-BPAT report.
It was totally inadequate. The BPAT study was, for the size of this disaster, I mean, these are the two largest buildings in the world as far as the Twin Towers go, two of the largest buildings in the world to collapse, and yet we were throwing at it volunteer engineers with no money and no authority, basically.
The only access they had was one guide, what was they described as a guided tour. They didn't even look at a single piece until like a month after the attack.
There was no NIST investigation. There was no $16 million. There was no federal look at this disaster other than the federal BPAT. And that's why we're very critical to BPAT. Again, not the individuals conducting it, but the way it was being conducted. It was, again, failed, to do what really needed to be done. And it was much, it stopped very short of what this disaster deserves.
It's a very well-designed building, you know. Leslie Robertson and those gentlemen did a good job designing it, actually. It's not hollow. I get that argument from some people. They say, well, it's hollow, you know, it's just weird. It's like a can. Soda pop can, you know, no, it's got these huge core columns going up the center. This huge antennas, right about 350 feet tall, is sitting on the core columns.
Kevin Ryan was a former manager for Environmental Health Laboratories, a water testing subsidiary of Underwriter Laboratories, or UL. UL certified the original World Trade Center steel and performed steel tests for the NIST report. Months after being promoted to site manager of his division, Kevin Ryan was fired for publicly questioning the NIST draft report released in October of 2004.
They were given an award in 1971 by the American Society of Civil Engineers as being the greatest engineering achievement, the greatest contribution to engineering in mankind. The American Society of Civil Engineers, right? So these were very well-built buildings. John Skilling was given another award around about then by the AISC group, the American Institute of Steel Constructors. So these were award-winning buildings and award-winning engineers. John Skilling said he took all this airplane impacts and jet fuel fires into account and that the building structure would still be there. And the reason I believe he said that is these were totally over-designed for calamities. Obviously, you're building these super high buildings that are, at the time, the tallest buildings ever built. And they took into account aircraft impacts and jet fuel fires in their design.
With me is one of the architects who helped to design the World Trade Center, Aaron Swirsky.
Each floor by itself, it's sort of like an hermetic unit. It was designed even like for fire, that there were shutters that would shut off the ducts, the vertical openings, and that the fire couldn't travel from one floor to the other. Now that this collapsed, it's really an incredible thing.
It looked on the footage, what I saw on CNN, that the plane flew straight into the building.
Straight through him, right. Yeah.
So you're saying that the building was actually designed to cope with a hole like that and
right.
then still
yeah.
survive?
Yeah, it was designed like that. Yeah, that's what happened. It was the explosion in 1993. If you remember that it opened a big hole in the structure, but it was at the end of the structure, and at that point the intent was to topple the building, to collapse, but because of the design it didn't collapse. But now I mean it's unbelievable. I don't know, it's just it was designed like to withstand something like that, and that's incredible because the entire design of the building was designed around that eventuality that an accident may occur.
The planes that crashed into the towers were 767-200s, and sometimes those are called jumbo jets. Well, they're actually not much bigger than the original plane that was in existence when the towers were built, which was a 707-340. They're actually fairly comparable. A 767 is slightly heavier than a 707. it has only a slightly higher fuel capacity, and a 767 has a cruising speed that is only 530 as opposed to 607 for a 707. Now, kinetic energy goes up with the square of velocity, so a typical crash event of a 707 would actually involve more kinetic energy, and the planes that crashed into the towers didn't have anywhere near their full fuel load. They only had about 10,000 gallons, according to official estimates. You have an event that's well within the design parameters of the building, and then the official story has that these buildings turned into dust and small pieces of shredded steel as a result of that.
Hyman Brown, the construction manager of the Twin Towers, said they were over-designed to withstand almost anything, including hurricanes, bombings, and an airplane hitting them. And even Thomas Eagar, an MIT professor of materials and engineering science who supports the official theory, says that the impact of the airplanes would not have been significant because the number of columns lost on the initial impact was not large, and the loads were shifted to remaining columns in this highly redundant structure. Likewise, the NIST report, in discussing how the impact of the airliners played a role, focuses primarily on the claim that the planes dislodged a lot of the fireproofing material from the steel.
The floor assemblies were covered with fireproofing. The columns were covered with fireproofing. The fireproofing was actually undergoing an upgrade. NIST's report comes right out and says, if it weren't for fireproofing loss, forget all the impacts, forget the fires, we had to have widely dislodged fireproofing or these buildings would never have collapsed. So they need to have all the fireproofing stripped off.
2 1/4.
I pointed out that earlier calculations showed that the energy simply was not there. But NIST did these really weak and deceptive tests. Well, they slipped this Appendix C into one of the reports in the end. And this shows this little assembly, this plywood box, and they have a shotgun. They took the shotgun and they shot 15 blasts at non-representative samples, ultimately, and showed that where they shot the fireproofing would blow off. Okay. One of the big problems with that is, first of all, there's no energy for any of this to happen. Secondly, there's no evidence that a 767 could transform into thousands of shotgun blasts, pointing in all different directions, by the way. Going through the core of the building, coming around to the outside, shooting all the insulation off, right underneath the floors, over several floors, let alone 9 floors, for crying out loud. It's just not possible. And so it's very deceptive. The fireproofing could not have been widely dislodged because there was no energy and there's no mechanism to do so.
So the official theory of the collapse is essentially a fire theory. So it cannot be overemphasized that fire has never caused large steel frame buildings to collapse. Never. Whether before 9/11 or after 9/11 or on 9/11 anywhere else in the world except allegedly New York City.
Initially, you had news reports saying, well, this was the plane, the jet fuel melted the steel, and somehow that steel then ends up in a pool. Well, first of all, that won't explain Building 7, which wasn't hit by a plane. Yeah. No plane, no jet fuel. Okay, so where'd the molten metal come from?
There had been some metallurgy tests done by Frank Gale. He was a member of the NIST team. He was the leader of Project 4 out of 8 projects, which was a study of the metallurgy, was the analysis of the steel. These tests that had been done on the steel samples, the few steel samples that had been saved, one of them was a paint deformation test that Frank Gale's group had done, and it showed how paint would curl or change in a certain temperature range. And so they took these samples and they analyzed them to see what temperatures they might have been exposed to by looking at the paint. Less than 2% of these samples, which had been pulled specifically from the fire zones in, And they even said, despite pre-collapse exposure to fire, less than 2% of them had seen temperatures of 480 degrees Fahrenheit, which is very low relative to the temperatures needed to soften or melt steel.
These fires, it doesn't matter if it's diesel fuel, office materials, including paper, or jet fuel, they aren't hot enough to melt steel, these structural steel beams. To melt it requires approximately 1530 centigrade, about 2800 Fahrenheit. You can't heat the steel long enough with these fires to melt it.
The problem with floors not collapsing was a big one, because that's really where all the experts were hanging their hat on, this pancake theory.
There are people who have looked at this and said, well, you see, what happened was that the floors got hot, they would sag and pull away from the core and start collapsing.
There were articles coming out in like Newsday from New York that said, well, these floor models didn't fail in the furnaces. You know, they all passed the test for 2 hours. 2 hours, of course, is longer than either of the buildings stood. That was a red flag for me, right? And then I was even more interested in reading this report. You can't have pancaking without floor collapse. In October 2004, when the Popular Science magazine article came out that NIST scientists jumped on board and supported, they were still talking about pancaking, right? That was in early 2005. And that all contradicts the UL floor model tests. None of the samples actually had reached temperatures that would show that the steel might have lost half of its strength. The summary that talked about steel softening and buckling, that directly contradicts Frank Gale's results. The temperatures that were seen by the steel samples were not high enough to soften or melt any kind of steel, even unfireproof steel. So those were the kind of questions that I was asking Frank Gale about, trying to get answers on. I really felt, honestly, that he was going to give me a response. I thought he was going to say, wow, you're right, you know, or well, this is why they're still talking about this. He never responded to me.